Today I am going to give a lecture on superconductivity, the most promising area for research work. Kamerlingh Ohms, a Dutch physicist, actually discovered this superconductivity in 1911. Just he performed an experiment with mercury. Just I will explain you the experiment regarding the superconductivity. Using mercury, while he is experimenting with it, he studied variation of resistance with respect to temperature. Suddenly, at a temperature 4.2 Kelvin, approximately the boiling temperature of helium, the resistance of mercury disappeared. So, from normal conducting state to mercury switched over to another state, of course known as superconducting state. Now, what is superconductivity phenomena? Let us see. When a specimen is cooled to a sufficient low temperature, suddenly its resistance drops to zero. This phenomena is known as superconductivity. The temperature at which the resistance of the specimen disappears is known as transition temperature or sometimes critical temperature. So, in the case of mercury, Kamerlingh Ohms observed that the transition temperature is 4.2 Kelvin because at 4.2 Kelvin, the resistance of mercury became zero. Now, there are so many alloys and metals, those will exhibit this superconductivity nature. Some niobium, lead, etc. are some examples we can say. Now I would like to mention some experimental facts and properties of superconductors. Superconductivity is connected with electrons but not with atoms. So the X-ray diffraction studies reveals that there is no change in crystal structure of a superconductor. It means that when a normal conductor is converted into a superconductor, then there won't be any change in its crystal structure. This is the first and foremost property or experimental fact we can say. The second one is, suppose if we add any impurity to the basic structure, the magnetic properties will change and there will be a change in transition temperature, but the specimen will not lose its superconducting nature. The superconducting materials at room temperature are having more resistivity than other elements. This is another important property that we have to see in the case of superconductors. There are some properties, those will not change when a normal conductor is converted into superconductor. For example, elastic properties, photoelectric properties, these properties will not change in superconducting state. However, there are some properties, those will change in superconducting state. The heat capacity, the specific capacity or specific heat, entropy, etc. These thermal properties will change when a normal conductor is converted into a superconductor. Here I would like to mention an important point regarding entropy. Generally, if a reaction takes place in this nature, we know that the entropy increases, but here When a normal conductor is converted into a superconductor, the entropy decreases. That we have to observe. Because the superconducting state is more ordered state when compared with a normal normal conductor. So that is why here entropy decreases. Now let us see three important phenomena in the case of superconductivity. Here the first one is isotopic effect. The product of transition temperature and square root of atomic mass remains constant in the case of isotopes. So this relation is shown in the diagram, Tc into root m equals to constant. If atomic mass increases, the transition temperature changes in accordance with the atomic mass of the isotope. This effect is known as isotope effect. Next, I would like to define an important parameter in superconductivity, that is nothing but critical field. What is critical field? Critical field is that applied magnetic field which destroys the superconducting nature of a superconductor. So here we can understand the superconducting nature is not only governed by transition temperature but also magnetic field. So the maximum magnetic field strength which can destroy superconducting nature of a superconductor is known as critical field, and this critical field changes in accordance with the transition temperature or critical temperature. Now I would like to mention an equation, HCT equals to HC0 1 minus T square by TC square. HC of T is nothing but it is the critical field at a absolute temperature T. HC0 is critical field at 0 Kelvin and T is taken temperature, we know that, and TC is critical temperature or transition temperature of the superconductor. So the superconducting nature not only depends upon transition or critical temperature but also critical field. Below that critical field only the material will act as superconductor, otherwise it will lose its superconducting nature and will be converted into a normal conductor. Normal conductor means it will again possess resistance. So critical field is very important regarding our superconducting phenomena. Now let us see an important effect known as Meissner effect. Magnetic levitation is actually the application of this Meissner effect. Now what is Meissner effect? When a superconducting material in a magnetic field is cooled below its transition temperature, then magnetic flux already present in it will be ejected out. This is known as Meissner effect. Now let us see the explanation. In this diagram, this is a superconducting material which is placed in magnetic field so that the magnetic flux is passing through this superconducting material. However, when it is cooled below its transition temperature TC, in the second diagram we can observe the magnetic flux already present in it will be ejected out. This is actually the Meissner effect. According to Meissner, a superconductor is a diamagnetic material. Since there is no magnetic flux inside the material in superconducting state, if you want to define superconductor, then according to Meissner, superconductor is nothing but a diamagnetic material. It is better to define in that manner. So a superconductor is a diamagnetic material. Now let us see some conditions regarding this Meissner effect. The first and foremost is Messner effect is completely reversible. In nature, almost all processes those are taking place are irreversible. But if we come to Messner effect, no doubt Messner effect is reversible, because if that temperature is greater than transition temperature, then magnetic flux will travel through the material. Suppose if it is cooled below its transition temperature, the magnetic flux already present in it will be ejected out. So you can go to second condition from the first condition, or you can come to first condition from the second condition. That is why I can say Messner effect is reversible process. Now, perfect diamagnetic nature, that we can understand using this equation. We know that B equals to mu naught into H plus I, where H is known as magnetizing field and I is known as intensity of magnetization. For superconductor, or in the case of a superconductor, B equals to 0. Therefore, mu naught into H plus I equals to 0. This implies I equals to minus H. We know that magnetic susceptibility is defined as, it is the ratio of intensity of magnetization to magnetizing field. But here I equals to minus H. Therefore, chi or magnetic susceptibility equals to minus H by H. It comes out to be minus 1. So, for a perfect diamagnetic material, we know that susceptibility is negative. So, in this way, we can say that according to Messner effect, superconductor is a perfect diamagnetic material. Now, I would like to move to a surprising result, that is condition 3. According to Maxwell's relation, we know that curl E bar equals to minus dou B bar by dou T. And also we can prove that E equals to J rho, where J is known as current density and rho is resistivity. But in the case of a superconductor, we know that resistivity rho equals to 0. So if rho equals to 0, automatically E comes out to be 0. Therefore, dou B by dou T equals to 0. This in turn gives you B equals to constant, and it is an unexpected result again, or it is a surprising result, because as far as our superconductor is concerned, we know that it is being a perfect diamagnetic material, there is no B in it, but here we got a result B equals to constant. So in this way we can explain Messner effect, and it is a very, very important effect in superconductivity. Now let us discuss type 1 and type 2 superconductors. On the behavior of magnetic properties, we can classify superconductors into two types: type 1 superconductors and type 2 superconductors. Now let us see in detail what are these two types of superconductors. Now come to type 1 superconductor. It is also known as soft superconductor. If we see in the diagram, type 1 superconductor is characterized by one critical field. We know that the superconductivity nature is not only decided by transition temperature, but also with critical field. Below the critical field, it will exhibit superconducting like nature. So, a type 1 superconductor is nothing but, it is characterized by a single critical field, of course, which is very low in this case. Now, below HC or critical field, it acts as a superconductor. It means that it acts as a perfect diamagnetic material, and it will exhibit complete Messner effect below HC. These superconductors are soft superconductors, and their critical field is very low. This is type 1 superconductor. Now let us move to type 2 superconductors. What are type 2 superconductors? Type 2 superconductors are characterized by two critical fields, HC1 and HC2, as shown in the diagram. Now, below the first critical field or HC1, the material will exhibit complete Meissner effect and it acts as a superconductor in all ways. But in between HC1 and HC2, it will have a mixed state or a complicated mixed behavior. However, it is a superconductor electrically between these two fields, but magnetically it will not obey complete Meissner effect. So this type of superconductors are known as type 2 superconductors, and this mixed state between HC1 and HC2 is known as vortex state. Beyond HC2, if we make any attempt to increase the field, automatically it will be turned into normal state. So in this way, type 2 superconductors, of course, also known as hard superconductors, and they will have two critical fields. Now let us see some applications of superconductors. The first and foremost application is power transmission. Suppose if superconducting cables are used for power transmission, without any appreciable loss of power, we can transfer power from one place to another place. We know that in the case of a normal conductor, when electric power or electric current travels through the cable, there will be a heat loss. According to Joule's law, H equals to I square RT. Here I is current, strength of the current, R is resistance of the conductor, and T is time of flow. In the case of a superconductor, we know that R equals to 0. If R equals to 0, then automatically the heat loss becomes 0. So, no heat loss will be there here in the case of a superconducting cables. So, this is very, very important application of superconductors. Now, the second one is magnetic coils prepared with superconducting materials. Suppose we know that in the case of an electromagnetic coil, when electric current is allowed to pass through the coil, then it acts as an electromagnet. Now, if we prepare these electromagnetic coils with superconducting materials or superconductors, once if we set up electric current in the coil, it will last forever. Since there is no heat loss or there is no resistance for this coil, so without any loss, automatically this current persists forever. And also using these superconducting electromagnets, we can produce very strong magnetic fields. These are very useful in MRI and also particle accelerators, etc., etc. So the third application is SQUIDs. SQUID means superconducting quantum interference device. These are the magnetic flux storages. The principle of SQUID is nothing but Josephson effect. What is Josephson effect? When two superconductors are separated by a very thin material, and if current is allowed to pass through one superconductor, then it will be inducted into the second superconductor. This effect is known as Josephson effect, and this principle is used in the preparation of superconducting quantum interference devices. The next application is in computers. Suppose if the components in the computers are made up of the superconducting materials or superconductors, then the speed of action of the computer will be enhanced, and also the efficiency of the computer will be more when compared with the ordinary computers. So in this way, we can improve the efficiency of a computer by using these superconductors in its hardware. Squids are also used to find out minute magnetic field effects in the human brain. This is an important application of a squid. Superconductors are used in maglev. Now, what is maglev? Maglev is nothing but magnetic levitation. Using this principle, the trains will travel in air without touching the rails. Since there is no friction, the speed of the train will be approximately 500 km per hour. So, Messner effect is the principle for the maglev, and this is another important application of a superconductor. Now, let us discuss about occurrence of superconductivity. Why the superconductivity is occurring in some materials when they are cooled below transition temperature? Now, what is the mechanism involved in it? Normally, in a conductor, why we are getting this resistance? Here, when free electrons or conduction electrons are traveling through a conductor, collisions will take place between these electrons and vibrating positive ions in the lattice. Due to this, resistance occurs in the case of a normal conductor. But in the case of a superconductor, the electrons will be paired, or they will be in the form of Cooper pairs. Whenever they travel in pairs, they will not encounter any scattering in the lattice. Actually, this theory is known as BCS theory, and the two important points in the BCS theory are, number one, formation of Cooper pairs or electron pairs, and number two, electron lattice electron interaction via phonon field. The mechanism involved in the formation of Cooper pairs or electron pairs is nothing but electron lattice electron interaction via phonon field. In the case of superconductors, these electron pairs or Cooper pairs will travel in the material, so they will not encounter any type of scattering under this condition, and thus that leads to zero resistance. In other words, we can say the resistance vanishes and the conductivity becomes infinity. So approximately this is the mechanism that is taking place in the case of superconductivity. Now, the superconductivity is the most promising area for the researchers, and I request the research people just go through the superconductivity and try to find a superconductor which acts as a superconductor at room temperature. Then the whole world will change. Best of luck.